If you ask. So today, we welcome back AHA Director Roy Speckhardt and his wife, AHA Director of Development and Communications, Maggie Ardente. Roy will be speaking to us and then answering questions. And I think he wants to intersperse a little bit of Q&A, so if you have some sort of burning question related specifically to what he's saying at the moment, raise your hand, and I'll try and get you the mic promptly. So Roy has served as Executive Director of the American Humanization, the American Humanists Association since 2005. He's a frequent media commentator. He's appeared on TV many times on shows such as Good Morning America. He's been on CNN, NPR, among others, even Fox News. He also writes a regular column for the Huffington Post and has given speeches at colleges and conferences and local humanist groups such as ours. Roy also serves on the boards of the Institute for Humanist Studies and the Humanist Institute and the Secular Coalition for America Education Fund. He's a member of the advisory board of the Religious Freedom Center of the Newseum Institute. And if you haven't seen the museum in Washington, D.C., it's quite a treat. He also served as deputy director of the Interfaith Alliance in the late 90s. He has an MBA from George Mason University and a BA in sociology from Mary Washington College. And he currently lives in Washington, D.C. with his wife and is leading the premier humanist organization that's under the American Humanist Association. So he will be. Also, he's the author. Sorry, I get this a little. He's the author of the book Creating Change Through Humanism. And he has copies and will be signing and selling them at the back after the forum. And I'd like to have you all give a warm welcome to Roy Speckhardt.
Well, thanks so much. So after working in the humanist movement for over a decade, I really wanted humanism to mean something that everybody could understand. I wanted humanism to stand for something that would make a difference in people's lives. And I want humanism to grow so it can have an increasing impact. So I wrote Creating Change Through Humanism with a description of humanism that I hope will spur some discussion and debate that'll prompt us to work together to continue to evolve this ever-evolving philosophy. Now, the foreword is written by Dr. Rebecca Neuberger Goldstein, who is a prolific author and a professor of philosophy at Harvard. She writes, "Until quite recently, I was unaware of the existence of the secular humanist community, organized around the values of rationality, free inquiry, and the right each of us has to flourish in this life, which is the only life that any of us will ever get. But sadly, this is problematic. The idea that someone swimming in Dr. Goldstein's circles isn't even aware of the secular humanist movement. We have to find ways to make our humanist convictions clearer and more inviting. This is possible. Several years ago, I presented here, and I asked the audience a question about how many years it would take before we achieved marriage equality in every state of the Union, including this one, of course. A few raised their hands when I said 10 years. You know, some more folks raised their hands when I said 20 years. But to get a full majority, I had to say, you know, in the next 50 years, we're going to get there, right? But here we are, just several years later, and at least that one mission is accomplished. Dr. Goldstein gives us some of the tools to proceed and overcome the challenges we face as non-theists. She says, if you believe in the integrity of your conclusions, you must show them to the world, making a case for them not only by the arguments you hash out in the privacy of your own mind, but in the life that you publicly lead. Or as she quotes from later in the book, when you no longer need to feign an identity that isn't yours, you'll discover confidence in the ability to say, this is who I am, and speak out on any issue that stirs your heart and mind. By announcing your presence, to others will come out to you as about their non-theism, and you can love and be loved by the people who know the real you, no matter what you've been told. That person deserves to see the light of day. So what does it mean to be a humanist? And I want to get some of your ideas on this subject. You know, what are some of the specific elements that make up humanism? What are your thoughts? Raise your hand.
Shut up.
You go ahead.
Respect for others.
I'll let them. These are short, so I'll let people.
Okay. Yeah, these will be probably pretty short. So respect for others. Yeah, that's a good one. Others? Other thoughts here?
Seeking real good.
Seeking real good. Yeah, I like that. Okay. Others?
Accountability in the here and now.
Accountability in the here and now. Okay.
Firm in your convictions.
Say that one.
Firm in your convictions.
Firm in your convictions. That's interesting.
Belief in science as a process.
Belief in science as a process. Very good. More. What captures your humanism? Do you feel like you've heard it already? Yeah.
Quality. Valuing every human being.
Valuing human beings. Every human being. Yeah. I think that's a key aspect. It brings into mind some of the key pieces of humanism. Well, humanism isn't a religion in the traditional sense, as there are no overarching, unchanging rules, no set of beliefs one must follow, no higher power one must give over to, no requirement to attend services or pray at bedtime. It's not just a philosophy in the common sense, because it informs beyond the boundaries of pursuit of knowledge into daily living. It's not a political dogma. It doesn't dictate a specific platform of unchanging views. Some call it a worldview or a life stance because it's intended to address all the realms traditionally associated with philosophy, religion, and simply living the good life. Humanism is the not-so-radical idea that you could be good without a God. It's the discovery that you not only don't need outdated texts or God experts to make good choices, but in fact that those are often not the best resources for decision-making. Humanists affirm our ability and responsibility to lead ethical lives of personal fulfillment that aspire to the greater good of humanity. We ground that pursuit not in otherworldly ideas, but in the best of modern knowledge, as determined from trial and error and the scientific process, which makes humanism a foundation for strong convictions, as was mentioned. The first pillar of humanism is the unflagging dedication to the scientific method as our source for knowledge, relied upon because experience proves it reliable. Science isn't just something done by PhDs in lab coats and some ivory tower institutions. It's what we do every day. When a child in her high chair takes some food and throws it on the ground to see what happens, that's science. Believing knowledge of the world is derived through observation, experimentation, rational analysis, rules out supernatural sources, unexamined dogma, and simplistic or absolute concepts of good and evil. Humanists don't simply disbelieve traditional religious explanations. Rather, we often find that those explanations just don't stand up to reasonable scrutiny. Another pillar of humanism is empathy, which links science with what distinguishes humanism as a positive philosophy. Empathy is the capacity to recognize and share feelings of others. In 1933, Albert Einstein wrote, "There is one thing we do know, that we are here for the sake of others, above all, for those upon whose smile and well-being our own happiness depends." By walking in another's shoes, by stepping outside of our preconceptions and personal limitations, we can see an idea from another perspective. This gives us insights into views other than our own. We learn what it feels like to experience realities we haven't even faced, giving us a chance to learn from trial and error without the trial. That's a tremendous advantage. And the more we cultivate it, the more we can benefit personally and as a society. It's through this cultivation of empathy that we develop a deep-seated compassion for humankind and the world at large. Empathy and compassion helped us advance as a species, for it was survival for those who would look out for each other back at one time. And we do well to remember this on a global scale as we confront some challenges to our very existence. Now, such a commitment to compassion might only have a modest effect on our views if it wasn't for an accompanying commitment to an egalitarian-based sense of fairness that a couple of you kind of alluded to in your responses about humanism. Because without, even compassion without egalitarianism would be hollow. It'd be reminiscent of the compassion of ancient Hindu societies, which undid their interest in compassion by stratifying society into castes, allowing many to be considered less than human. And similarly, some pre-Civil War Christian leaders urged their slave owners to be kind to their slaves, but such compassion is worthless in the confines of slavery. And when conservative Christians or Muslims, or President Trump says that husband should be head of the household but use his power kindly, they fool themselves to think that that's a kind of meaningful compassion. The principle of egalitarianism is the conviction that humans are basically equal despite differences in aptitude, and that each person should be treated as having inherent worth. There's plenty of room for differing outcomes based on intellect, ability, and hard work, but acceptance of inequality between ethnic, cultural, or other groups as a grounds for discrimination isn't supportable by humanist reasoning. Which leads us to the conclusion we are one world with one people on it. So, I have another question for you. Is science compatible with traditional religion?
No.
Flat no.
Flat no.
This one I might want a little more. You might want to use the mic for this, but I do want some responses. What do you think? Can science be compatible with traditional religion?
Science gives us a reliable epistemology for testing truth claims. So to the extent that a religion makes truth claims, they bear the burden of proof. To the extent that you want to go into other areas, go right ahead.
All right. Other thoughts?
I think that the field of psychology in science recognizes that, in general, people tend to need something to believe in higher than themselves in order to cope with things that are difficult in life.
Okay. Other thoughts?
No. Yeah, I say no, because in science we reject the notion of supernatural influences in the world.
There's a hand up over on the side here, after that one.
Just been kind of aware that the tree of knowledge is really science in the Bible, and you know, we were taught to avoid the tree of knowledge, otherwise we'll be cast out or whatever.
Over here.
I would say no, because traditional religion as opposed to science. Science encourages critical thinking and investigation, whereas religion, especially in terms of morality, it's more a decree. So morality by fiat.
Generally speaking, I would say no, but you say traditional religion.
Uh-huh.
Well, Scientology is hardly traditional, but it has nothing close to science. The Catholic Church accepts evolution. It's pretty traditional, but generally speaking, I would say no.
Right. Yeah, it's interesting when we kind of explore into some of the details there. As Unitarian Universalist President Peter Morales wrote in a journal article, science is based on a radically democratic way of knowing, in the sense that scientific truth is comprised of the things we can all experience, not private experiences accessible only to gifted individuals. Morales accurately points out that science is a process for obtaining information where any person can change everybody else's minds if they can prove their point. There's no faith required to accept what we've learned from science as being the best answers currently available. Or, as Neil deGrasse Tyson simply puts it, science is true whether you believe in it or not. This reliance on science as a process isn't really radical at all. What would be radical would be accepting knowledge obtained from any other source. Unfortunately, in the same article, and I've talked with Peter about this a little bit, Peter Morales makes the mistake of trying to carve out part of our world and suggest it somehow outside of the laws that explain everything else. He writes, "Questions about meaning are not scientific questions," and goes on to relegate such questions to the realm of religion, as if untouched by science. But this tendency to create a safe space for religion, tucked away from the rigors of science, so as to avoid it being disproved, is at least an oversight. In truth, we can and do use the same scientifically rigorous approaches of observation, analysis, trial and error, and conclusion when approaching questions of meaning and purpose. In fact, for some, the path to humanism itself is trial and error. Comedian George Carlin said, "I've begun worshiping the sun for a number of reasons. First of all, unlike some other gods I can mention, I can see the sun. It's there for me every day. It brings me things that are quite apparent all the time. Heat, light, food, and a lovely day. There's no mystery. No one asks me for money. And I don't have to dress up. And interestingly enough, I've found that the prayers that I offer to the sun and the prayers I formerly offered to God are all answered at about the same 50-50 rate." All this considered, the break with traditional theism is a challenging one, and we should give people experiencing this internal struggle a chance to decide for themselves. There are even millions of Americans, who retain labels from traditional faith traditions, such as Catholic or Jewish or Buddhist, but don't believe in an intervening God. This was first clearly revealed to me, at least, in the Pew Religious Landscape Survey in 2009. And they asked the question a certain way there that they didn't in the future. I don't know why. But it was very interesting to see how many people in different faith traditions are pretty certain there is no God. Who wants to guess where you can find the most non-theists in what religious category?
Catholic.
Yes, it is Catholic. That's right. You get over 500,000 Americans are Catholic but are atheist in by belief. They wouldn't necessarily use atheist as their identifier. Some might, but they use Catholic as their identifier, but they don't actually believe in God. By percentage, it's interesting, Jewish Americans, only 25% of Jewish Americans believe in a personal God, which is kind of mind-blowing when you think about what you see politicians talk about. They assume that everyone believes a certain way when, you know, the information just shows it to be a little different. Now, should humanists be quiet about our non-theism? What do you think?
No.
This idea of what politicians talk about, why is it when such a large percentage of the population, I mean a significant portion of the population, there are more atheists and agnostics than there are blacks, there are more atheists and agnostics than there are Jews, and yet we get no political clout whatsoever.
Yeah, why is it? What is this mystery about why non-theists, humanists, agnostics, however you want to call us, free thinkers, don't seem to have representation in politics and in public life to a degree. Although the public life part is starting to change. You see TV shows and things like that recognizing that we exist. And some politicians do. In fact, George W. Bush said something about us that was kind of nice just recently. I don't know if folks heard it. He said that we had to respect people who don't believe as well as those who do. Kind of critiquing Trump, actually.
He finally came around.
Yeah, he came around a little bit, yeah. Now that he's not in office. I think there's this fear of folks in office, and we've seen that a little bit. This is on video, so I have to be a little careful. But we've seen that a little bit with existing politicians, too. Some of whom we've met and who confide in us that they are humanists through and through, that they don't believe in anything. You know, and I say, you know, can't you just say you're agnostic, you know? And they're like, well, I'm not an agnostic, I'm an atheist. I'm like, well, say something about how you feel. It's sometimes difficult to convince them that it's okay and that they're not going to lose support. The numbers are there, though. And especially in some districts, there's really no reason for them not to be public. And I think sometimes there's going to be a tipping point where politicians start recognizing that. And that tipping point may be pretty soon. Well,
as I understand it, polls have consistently shown that if you ask people across the board, what are the least respectable?
Yes,
is
yes.
it lawyer? Is it doctor? Is it atheist? Always comes at the bottom.
It has come at the bottom. Recently, we've been moving up a little. So the question that is most commonly used that I've heard is like, would you vote for a otherwise qualified candidate for public office who happened to be a, and then atheist or Jew or whatever, you know? We used to be, you'd get 42% that would say yes to atheist, and now we're up to 54%. And that's just a little above Muslim right now, but that could be part of the bigotry of our president kind of stirring things up.
The history of religion is too heavily entrenched. So our present course of humanism is not as prevalent.
So say what were you...
The history of religion is so heavily entrenched.
True.
So we're not getting anywhere fast because...
Yeah, it's true. It's hard to displace that. I mean, we were just in India last month, and you see that. I mean, the history of religion, of course, goes back so far. And but it was interesting in India to see how people get along, or used to get along. So you'd see a contemporary temple from dated back 1100 BCE that was a Hindu temple right next to a Jain temple and a Buddhist temple, and they just got along. They didn't seem to mind each other. We could use some of that today. but yeah, there is this history, and overcoming that is not an easy thing. Well, not believing in God may not be the dominant issue in your personal life. I mean, most humanists understandably have a much more positive agenda than that. But it has to be recognized that it's meaningful to others. If people are to be respected, they deserve to know who we are. There's a reason Americans swear to uphold the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And failing to uphold the truth when what's withheld matters is a failing we should strive to overcome. Closeted non-believers once showed their bravery, putting aside comforting religious stories about existence in favor of scientific understandings of the universe, and even our seemingly small role in it. If they can tap into their reservoirs of bravery again and fight the silence regarding their non-belief, they don't need to conceal themselves from others who they care about. We should be clear about who we are, not for the purpose of offending anybody, but regardless of whether our very existence does cause offense. Part of deciding whether you're in the right place or not is hearing some of the journeys other folks took to get there. Now, I know a lot of folks who are in the humanist movement were raised in a particular religious tradition, but some folks were raised secularly or in free thought households. How many folks like that are here today? Yeah. Anybody have secular or humanistic grandparents too? I know one person does. Mike Werner, our president of our trustees, his granddaughter's here. Any great grandparents that go that far? No, we're not sure, maybe. Sometimes it's hard to know, right?
I had one parent.
One parent. Well, for the rest of us, seeing how others followed a similar path of falling away from a former faith that increasingly didn't make sense to them is a good way to affirm our own experience. For example, Dr. Anthony Pinn, an AHA board member, is the leading scholar on African-American humanism in the United States. His transformation was more dramatic than mine, so I like to tell his story. Tony was raised in a profoundly religious environment in Buffalo, New York, with his devout mother being the biggest influence on his early life, and the local minister tapping him for a career in the pulpit. Tony became a rising star in his African Methodist Episcopal Church, preaching his first sermon by the age of 12, and becoming ordained as an evangelical minister by the age of 18. Humanism wasn't an available option to him. In fact, Tony's religion was a speaking in tongues kind of faith, where one was expected to be regularly moved by a direct connection to a Holy Spirit in a God-fearing way. But with Christian life permeating much of his experience and himself on the doorstep to a life of distinction in the church, his intellectual curiosity had to be remarkably strong for him to walk down the roads that led to atheism and humanism. And it was. At New York's Columbia University, Tony began to modify his faith gradually from the literal Bible and evangelical position of revealed truth. Over time, he realized that the worlds of academia and the church were less and less compatible for him, and such seeds of doubt firmly planted. But it took attending Harvard Divinity School to make Tony an atheist and a humanist. His atheism spoke to what he no longer believed, and his humanism spoke to what he did believe regarding reason, compassion, and empathy. Many humanists experience anti-theistic periods in their life where they feel that countering the harm of religion is their best overall emphasis. Is this okay? Is it okay to spend some of our energy on critiquing religion? What do you think? Yes, yes. Why is that? I'd like a little more of your thoughts on that.
It's cathartic.
Makes us feel a little better. Kind of respecting that. Yeah, other thoughts?
Well, religions and people that are religious are in the habit of getting away with things by pointing it at another authority. It's okay if I do this because that book says it's okay to do this. And slavery was justified for a long time based on the Bible, among other atrocities that have occurred. So, you know, once in a while you got to say, well, maybe that book's not right.
I see. Well, so countering religion, what do you think?
Yeah, well, in a true scientific tradition, finding out what's wrong is a good way of finding out what's right.
That's right, we got to eliminate those options. Over here, I thought I had a hand. Over here.
They vote.
They vote, yes. And we have to be cognizant of that more and more. Right? Well, I think, though, it's fair to say, though, that the negative mindset of countering religion as our primary emphasis isn't really what characterizes the thrust of humanist aspirations, because it's tiresome to talk about what we always don't believe. But if we don't see anything to criticize in traditional religion, we might not be paying much attention. In Sam Harris's Letter to a Christian Nation, which was one of the books that really spurred the growth of our movement, he uncovered a dangerous weapon the religious right had been wielding against both the religious and the secular left. By convincing mainstream people of faith, as well as many secularists, that critique of religion was inherently wrong, the religious extremists in our midst got a free pass to hate whoever they wish, discriminate as they like, and seek laws that trample the rights of others, all free from criticism. Because if it's a taboo to criticize religion in politics, impolite to do it in circles where you have no problem engaging in other types of friendly debate, then such anti-humanist ideas go unchecked. We need to find the right balance that allows us to critique bad ideas but maintains respect for the people who have those ideas. Well, do you think sometimes people will take offense at our good without a God statement? You know, our, this one, I guess. AHA's motto. Will sometimes people take offense at that?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I think we do see that. Foundationally, I think fundamentalists believe that all goodness derives from their God. So the presence of anybody being good without their God is a constant reminder that something is wrong with their belief about the source of goodness. They fumble for other possibilities, like the improbable idea that all atheists are bad, or the absurd conclusion that atheists don't exist, that they've just deluded themselves into thinking they're atheists. On talk shows, you'd be surprised how often this comes up. They're like, you're not really an atheist. You know, you just are deluded. You think you're an atheist. I'm like, all right, that's what you need to say. That's why I think, though, that fundamentalists react with such remarkable aversion when they're confronted with the simple motto, good without a God. Why they characterize this positive personal statement, really, as a personal attack on them. They don't want to face the possibility you don't need their God in order to be good. But the fundamentalist break with humanism extends far beyond our conundrum of the godless goodnessness. In desperately trying to hold on to their faith in the presence of the real world they occupy, they have to draw lines in the sand before human evolution, elective abortion, same-sex marriage, and a whole slew of issues for which they don't agree with humanists. We actually face a threat today, especially now, and I don't think I need to say it because we're aware of that threat, but religious right leaders continue to get their supporters in federal and state governments to advance their extreme conservative sectarian agendas. They're working publicly and behind the scenes to push the appointment of far-right judges, and we see that especially with the new Supreme Court nominations. Regressive legislation all across the map, executive orders. They're also directly espousing their narrow religious views to the public. And as government publicly embraces religious beliefs, it inhibits academic freedom, compromises civil liberties, and tears down the wall of separation between religion and government. How many people know about the Johnson Amendment? About a good number, but I'll tell you a little bit about it. The Johnson Amendment, Lyndon Johnson, before he was president, got a bill passed that made sure that churches couldn't get involved in electoral politics. This makes sense because churches accept donations that are tax deductible, and they are anonymous. They don't have to report those donations to the government because we want to keep religion and government separate, and we don't want government getting entangled into religion and church politics, so that they don't have to report any of that information. So it's anonymous, tax-deductible money. So it shouldn't be spent on elections. Well, under the guise of saying that churches should have the chance to speak from the pulpit about whatever they feel about on election issues, Trump says he wants to get rid of this amendment. But what that would do would be like the Citizens United decision on steroids. I mean, it would be completely gutting all campaign finance laws because all money would go straight through churches, because who wouldn't want the tax deduction when they made that donation, right? Everybody would. And so all the electoral funding would go through churches, and we would see these churches become super PACs, and that would definitely stack the cards against us even more than they're already stacked with gerrymandering, which stacks them against progressives with all sorts of other things like that. And I think that this is a real key battle that we have to confront over the next year or so, because if we're unsuccessful, Trump's going to be looking at more than 4 years. It's going to be a lot easier for him to get elected with this out of the way. So let's kind of keep that in mind. So I think a new embrace of humanistic reason is needed to hold back this assault on our protections and prevent us from going down a path toward theocratic despotism. Humanism provides a needed philosophical foundation. It may not be dogmatic with unchangeable rules, but there is a consensus about humanists about our approach to issues. Without cataloging them, it frames the debate by highlighting the importance of human progress, human dignity, equality, global responsibility, civil liberties, secular society, the environment, and a commitment to science over blind faith and pseudoscience. While humanist positions aren't dogmatic, they're by no means apolitical. They do exhibit a tendency toward liberalism. So I have another question for you. Can you be a humanist and a conservative at the same time? What do you think? So I'd like your thoughts on this. Raise your hands, because I want mics for this, because this will, I don't want a yes or no, I want a little more.
Well, there are all kinds of conservatives, and yeah, you could be a fiscal conservative and still be a humanist, but to be socially conservative and a humanist at the same time, that's a little more problematic.
Others?
Environmentally, I've always been a conservative.
Right. Anyone else?
Okay. I want right in the front.
I don't think you can be both a true conservative and a humanist. For the simple reason that true conservatism, above all, supports the concept of oligarchic state or a what's the word, a type of society that it's not a democracy, it's a plutocracy. So a conservative supporting a plutocracy is already supporting a form of life that does not represent all people as fundamentally equal. And for that reason, I don't think a real conservative could ever be a humanist.
Interesting. Yeah. I think it is interesting when you think about, when you hear the word conservative, you know, you think of individuals who represent that view. You think of, what's it, CPAC, the conservative political action group that comes together to decide Republican platforms and things like that. Those views are often antithetical to humanism. And certainly, though, it is possible to hold some conservative views about one or a number of issues, especially when competing values are at stake. I know a number of dedicated humanists who seem to emphasize liberty over anti-violence measures when they express their interest in maintaining the ability to buy, own, and maybe even carry guns. But those same folks, if they're humanists, tend not to be extreme in their view. They're willing to accept things like waiting periods for gun purchases or mandatory registrations as ways to accommodate their values without facilitating violence. Similarly, I know humanists who believe the freedom to die can be precarious in its application, endangering those who are going through a mentally difficult time, exposing infirm people to risk of manipulation. But if they're humanists, they tend to see their position in moderation, frequently agreeing with Oregon's death with dignity laws that include safeguards confining the use to the terminally ill patients with doctor-certified controls of their mental capacities. In general, I find that humanists who describe their politics as conservative aren't anywhere near as conservative as the politicians that I deal with who are staff and members of Congress on Capitol Hill. So it's not automatically inconsistent with humanism to reach the rational conclusion that local government is preferable to federal government, or that the private sector can do some things better than the public sector, or that we don't want to burden our grandchildren with debt. If folks arrive at traditional conservative views through genuine reason and compassion, of course they're still humanists. Regardless of those individual differences, though, humanists of all stripes recognize that we need to work together to make things better, because no deity is going to do it for us. While we humanists don't agree amongst ourselves on everything, we might even change our minds from time to time, we have the insight to see that this can be our strength, not our weakness. We know that we need to work together because a form of religious fundamentalism has emerged and gained ground across this country that is both anti-secular and political, and it's a danger to the democracy and values we hold dear. So in conclusion, I know most of you care deeply about the environment, choice, education, and a myriad of other causes. But you took the time to be here. Humanism is what unites us. So let's emphasize that positive humanism like never before and create the change that we'd like to see. Thank you. So now I have time for a more general question and answer.
Do you think the fact, which you just alluded to, that humanism has so many different ideas and people that are sometimes diametrically opposed that consider themselves humanism, that that is really what precludes us from becoming kind of a political force? Because what would we pick? I mean, some are this, some are that. And how do we get around that so that we can be a little more effective? Because I feel like we're in some ways floundering in this current environment.
I hear you. I think that's an interesting point. We humanists tend to see small differences as cause for debate. So we might like to love to debate an issue about gun rights or something like that, or an issue about pornography, or, you know, like, we find these issues that we don't agree about, and we focus on them and have a lot of fun debating them. But what we don't always see through the forest through the trees on this is that we tend to agree on most things with the unanimity that you don't see anywhere else, in fact. For instance, Catholics, 83% of them believe Jesus is the Messiah. Now, you'd think that if you want to be a Catholic, that that's one thing about belief, right? Otherwise, what's the point, right? But no, apparently only 83%. But humanists, among our survey work that we've done, 95% and above believe in support same-sex marriage, support end-of-life choices, support all kinds of church-state separation issues. I mean, the amount of agreement that we have is actually stronger than you'd guess. But it is something that we need to work in coalescing with others. And that's something we got to get better at, for sure. Okay.
Hi, I'm just wondering, between atheists and humanists, I think maybe it's safe to say that all humanists are atheists, but are all atheists humanists, and why are there two separate groups?
Well, that's a good question. atheist, if I was to ask everybody in this room to write on a piece of paper what atheism means, even in this group, where we're presumably leaning quite heavily non-theist, right? We are not going to get agreement on that question. Because some people believe atheism means what the dictionary says, which is you don't happen to have a belief system that includes gods. That's all it means. Doesn't mean anything else, doesn't imply any positions, doesn't imply anything else. But most Americans, even folks in this room probably, think of atheism something different. Often it's synonymous with anti-religious, and people assume it's anti-religious. You ask random folks in Middle America, and they'll say that it's, you know, Satan worship. You know, like, you know, you get a lot of variety about what atheism means. I think that's part of the challenge. Now, is every humanist an atheist? My experience is no. Most humanists are atheists by definition, but only a slim majority of humanists would also identify as atheists because of the challenges with the word. And not all atheists are humanists. A good example of that. How open are these doors? You know, do we really invite everybody to be part of this group? Do we?
No.
Not quite. And by that, maybe anybody can come in and attend and hear what a session like this. But do we want to invite them to be part of the group, to be leaders in the group? I mean, and what is our drawing? Where do we draw the line on that? Do they have to be an atheist? Is that enough? Because Karl Rove is an atheist. He's very public about that. Would Karl Rove be a good leader of this group? Maybe not. You know. So you could be. You could not have a belief system that includes gods and still have a lot of oversights, you might say, about how the nature of humankind and how science works and things like that, and maybe just a overabundance of self-interest, I don't know. But so I think that humanism suggests that there's something more, that we've come to understand that through empathy and compassion and egalitarianism, we can make this world a better place, and that's where you get the additional for humanism. So I know, long answer, but there you go.
So then, back to your original question of how do humanists, it sounds like you're saying, and I think, you know, this is probably what I would agree with, that humanism is more of a positive, you know, and atheism is more from the negative sense, but it seems to be hard to put humanism forward with any kind of consistency, maybe, or, you know, something that identifies humanism as a philosophy, and,
yeah.
So do you go out as a humanist, and...
Yes.
Or do you go out as an atheist?
Definitely. I am not shy of using either term, but I think that it's important that we go out as a humanist and explain where we're coming from, how we've come up with our thinking. You know, lots of folks... One of the big prejudices against people who don't happen to believe in God is that they say that we're immoral, that we can't be trusted. because they have a wrong sense of how morality is constructed in the first place. You know, they think that it's given to us from a book when people make moral choices as a very young child, you know. Toddlers start figuring out morality when they play games with each other and what's right and wrong. I mean, we can see that when we're parents and grandparents and things like that. And you know, and then it doesn't take long before kids realize how to make rules on a game, and when they decide who breaks what rule, what the punishment should be, what the reward should be. You know, we're rule-making creatures, humans. We make morals all the time. We don't need an ancient book to tell us what to do. But a lot of society has been led to believe differently. And so that's something we have to re-educate about. Yeah.
I can't understand why it's so much negative talk about atheism and so positive on humanism. I'm an atheist and I think I'm a pretty moral guy.
Of course, of course, yeah.
I'd rather be an atheist than a humanist, to be honest.
Yeah. Well, you know, you have your choice how you identify. Certainly identify however you feel.
There's so much negativity.
And I think that ideally we would see more positive role models for atheism in the public. And we do have some, you know, people like Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie and, you know, a lot of Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Well,
he doesn't call himself an atheist, though. He doesn't. Neil deGrasse Tyson doesn't like labels. He says that every other week someone puts on his Wikipedia page that he's an atheist or a humanist or whatever, and he has to go and delete it. Because he doesn't really want to be pinned down by a label. I can understand where he's coming from there, because people have all kinds of assumptions about labels. And that's, I think, why we have to make an individual choice as to what label best suits ourselves. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that, and I don't think it necessarily divides us. We just have to find ways to work together across those boundaries of label.
David Silverman, the head of the American Atheisms, he mocks us. He says, Eschel, get off the pot.
I recently heard Dave's talk, and I was quite open with him about my critique of it. So Dave Silverman does this talk where he says that everybody should embrace the word atheism, and not humanism, not free thought, not these other words, because it works against us. But if you follow his presentation, early in the presentation he says that atheism is the most popular term. People understand it instinctively, they search it on the web, so forth and so forth. But I don't know if you remember what we said about 5 minutes ago, 10 minutes ago. People don't understand the word atheism. That assumption is incorrect. People actually misunderstand atheism more than almost any other term. And they may not be familiar with what we mean by humanism, but that makes it easy for us to explain what it is. So atheism has a real drawback in that it's commonly misunderstood. I'm happy to try to rehabilitate it as a term, but it's not rehabilitated already. It's not the silver bullet. We've got to work together regardless of what labels we use.
There are a lot of grassroots activist groups springing up all over the place at the moment. And depending on which ones you follow, you know, you'll get alerts, call your congressman today about issue A, or, you know, do this about issue B. Is the American Humanist Association going to follow specific issues and try to alert their member organizations in some way so that we can last people say about the Johnson Amendment or
definitely
Judge Gorsuch or whatever?
Oh, yes,
okay.
Definitely. We're doing some of that already, but we do plan to ramp that up in the coming weeks and months. We've done briefings on Capitol Hill for the Senate and the House on the Johnson Amendment recently, and we're engaging a lot of education on that, and we're going to be sending out alerts to our members and getting our local groups to be aware of them as well, because we've got to work to stop these things. It could really change the face of democracy in a negative way for decades or forever even, if we don't take action now. It's a really critical time.
Women's March.
Women's March. March for Science, Climate March. We're going to be involved in all those. Definitely. We were involved in the Women's March.
So join in, sign up for our email.
Sign up for our email. We have an action alert list, online, and that'll get you the weekly humanist.com e-zine as well, which is pretty much the most popular humanist, secular, whatever you call it, original content e-zine in the, that exists. So that's something to keep in mind too.
Yeah, we had a nice, as I mentioned in the announcements, we had a nice brainstorming discussion last week, and we're talking about different ways that people can become politically active, and our consensus was that people would prefer to be linked up with specific causes for the most part, rather than have Red Bank Humanism be a unique focal point for, you know, the myriad issues that people care about, because there are already organizations that are very well in tune with how to move forward on one issue or another. But I think on core issues of church-state separation and advancing humanist values, or not so much the myriad of values, but the more identity things and discrimination against non-believers and all that stuff, we will take a more active role in that. And we're very happy to get a feed from the AHA.
I think that's really important to get.
We will we'll highlight that in our in our web presentation of resources. So.
I mean, I think that we should be not too shy about getting involved in politics and issues. Yeah, it might be that not everybody agrees on an issue. But they say that, like, if you agree with half of what a, or no, if you agree with 80% of what an organization does, you should join. And if you agree with only half, you should be on its board. Right? So, you know, I mean, you should be involved, regardless if your group doesn't happen to agree with you on one position. I mean, that shouldn't be a deal breaker for us. But also, I find that when you get active on political issues, and when you get active in all kinds of ways, even just getting out in the community with charitable activities and the like, it draws people in. And so, yeah, you might lose a couple, but because you became active, because you're acting on your humanist values, you're going to gain more. So keep that in mind.
I know you spoke about talking to congressmen and senators and things like that.
Yes.
The AHA, do they have a legal staff that,
yes,
formulates amicus briefs when we have these issues come before the court?
Yes, we do. We have a legal staff in Washington, D.C. base, where we are based, and they, three lawyers, but we also have a pro bono legal team of over 120 lawyers across the country that we cooperate with in order to do amicus briefs, in order to file suits, in order to get engaged in all kinds of legal matters. We also have a legislative lobbying staff that are active on Capitol Hill, in addition to myself and Maggie pinch hitting here and there when we can. We're definitely engaged on those issues, definitely advocating for humanist issues. Oh yeah, big accomplishment we had in fall that I forgot about, but Maggie reminded me. We got the International Religious Freedom Act is a bill that has passed in the past, but was up for reauthorization last year. And we were able to get inserted into that bill, not just one place, but throughout the bill, protections not just for people of faith, but also for those who are humanists, agnostics and atheists and non-theists. That language, those words are in that bill throughout, and it passed. It wasn't just like some of our work, we're seeking resolutions supporting Darwin Day and National Day of Reason, which I think are very important and have gained momentum over the years, but this bill actually passed and was made into law. And so hopefully it doesn't get reversed anytime soon, but but we'll see. We'll have to keep an eye on that.
It was brought up a little while ago about where's all this negativity coming from, and your slogan, God, good without a God, if you look up the definition of sin, that's without a God, so you're sort of saying good sinner or something.
What is it about
God? Perhaps. I'm not sure I have a additional comment to add there.
Yeah, I have a couple, I guess, of comments, not so much questions. One is, but they're to the issues you brought up, of course. One is the, I tend to view humanism as the positive side of atheism, and I support FFRF as the pushback against the religion, which I do think we need to do, but that's the organization, or one of them, that does that. Second comment is that my wife found a way to express her atheism without using the word. and I think it was effective. She was on a jury, and somehow, I wasn't there, but somehow the issue came up and she said she didn't believe in God, and people said, why? And she said, well, look around. Does the world work as if there was a God somewhere? And they said, you know, you're right.
Yeah, it's not too hard to make that point today, sadly. That's right, that's right. Any more thoughts or questions?
I just have two closing thoughts. One is in response to Linda and several other people's questions. I think if you look at it simply as atheism, which you don't believe in, humanism is what you do believe in. I think that makes a big difference. The second thing is in terms of your encouragement for people's activism. I think personally that if this guy Gorsuch gets named to the Supreme Court, it will set human rights back by at least a generation. We wish we will not for a generation enjoy the human rights that we do today.
It's true, the courts are getting stacked against us, especially the federal courts with the appointments that are being made and are about to be made. It changes what we're able to do a bit. It means that we have to focus more on community activism, more on education of the public in changing people's hearts and minds one at a time. I mean, I think, you know, lots of people, I wasn't alone in being shocked at the election results, but part of that was not recognizing how people's positions had changed over time. And we've got to find ways to reach people directly and not try to always circumvent them through the courts, because we can't circumvent them through the courts with the courts not being on our side. We've got to find other ways. And so I think it means a little bit of more of a long-term strategy, and kind of laying the groundwork, the foundation for a humanist way of thinking. But we've got to be in it to win it. So that's what we've got to do. Anything else? Great.
Well, this is a good time. We seem to have gotten everyone's questions answered, and we're right at the hourly mark, I believe.
Well, that clock is a little odd. But we still have a little bit of time. So one last call for questions, and then we can do some book signing.
Oh, right, yes. I forgot about that.
Okay. You want to have one more round?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I just wanted to point out that Roy has a letter in our local paper, the Two River Times, this week, at the top of the editorial page, and it says, "Where do atheists fit in Trump's America?" I have never seen a document like this in that paper in 20 years I've been following. This is significant, and I think the turnout here is significant also. So this is a great start.
Well, thank you very much. Well, thank you all. It's been wonderful.